What's up, everyone? Welcome back to another part of probably my most popular What If right now. Last time, we saw the arrival of the androids, as well as Broly and Paragus fully being initiated into the Z Fighters as they became allied with our protagonists. Goku fell ill to the heart virus, and Gohan unlocked the wrathful form used by Broly. You can watch the last video here, linked at the top right of the screen. After the encounter with the androids, Piccolo flies off to the lookout to convince Kami to merge with him. Gohan and Broly, on the other hand, go off with Trunks as Bulma has just informed them that another time machine was just found nearby. The next bits of this arc go pretty normally. Piccolo and Kami merge and Piccolo meets the creature known as Cell. Like Trunks, we're gonna keep Cell's timeline the same as it is in canon, so he doesn't actually have Broly's DNA. The rest continues as normal, except Broly and Paragus are present, which doesn't change much about Cell either. Trunks and Krillin go back to Jiro's lab like usual, Bulma tries to analyze the blueprints for the androids, and Goku finally is recovered. Here, things begin to change slightly. Goku tells everyone about the hyperbolic time chamber and wants to take everyone there, but he can't instant transmission there, so the journey takes a little bit, but they still get to go there. The first to go in are Vegeta and Trunks. The other Saiyans outside train in the meantime. We begin to see a lot more changes here, and they're pretty drastic. The fight with Piccolo and 17 goes pretty much the same, with Cell defeating Piccolo, absorbing 17, and becoming semi-perfect. And Tien ends up blasting Cell with a tri-beam to allow 18 and 16 to escape. Goku and everyone on the lookout sense this going on, but they know they'll die if they go down there. Originally, Goku saved Piccolo and Tien by using instant transmission, but we know in this scenario, Goku never went to Yardrat. He doesn't have instant transmission, so this is the biggest downside to the story, because by changing Goku's destination, he doesn't have one of his most iconic techniques, which is a big problem. Without instant transmission, he can't save both Piccolo and Tien. Because of this, they end up being left there to bleed out and die, as Cell heads off. Gohan senses Piccolo dying, and Goku tries to stop Gohan from going down there, but they both end up going anyways. With two Senzus in hand, Gohan flies as fast as he can, with Goku, Broly, and Paragus chasing after him. He arrives first and finds Tien, who is barely alive, and he gives him a Senzu bean. Tien was on the brink of death, but is actually able to survive now, just barely. Gohan is desperately trying to search for Piccolo, as his energy fades into nothingness. Suddenly, it disappears completely. Gohan frantically looks around, and then fixates on something on the shoreline. It's Piccolo. A hysteric Gohan goes to Piccolo, desperately trying to wake him up. This is nearly the same as Trunks and future Gohan, if you remember how that went. Gohan realizes that Piccolo is dead, and he lets out a primal scream of sorrow and rage at the sight of Piccolo's death. His power rises immensely, even surpassing that of Goku and Broly at this point. A bright flash of light fills the area. The dust settles, and the three Saiyans and Tien see in front of them that Gohan has changed. Gohan has just went Super Saiyan from the loss of Piccolo. The four of them go over to console Gohan and try to calm him down, and they tell him they need to go back to the lookout right now. Gohan lets go of Piccolo's corpse, and he drops back into his base form and he passes out, both from shock and exhaustion from transforming into a Super Saiyan. The mood is solemn. Piccolo is dead, and while the Dragon Balls were gone before when he merged with Kami, they're now gone completely, and they don't see any way of being able to get them back with no Piccolo. At least for the time being. And Gohan had to witness the death of his best friend, and he couldn't do anything about it, and he's now a Super Saiyan. With no words spoken, Goku picks up Gohan, and the group heads back to the lookout. Tien feels pretty remorseful that he was the one to survive, and it meant Piccolo died, since he was found first, as sort of a survivor's guilt. But Goku assures him not to feel bad. There was nothing that could be done, and it's good that they were able to at least save one friend. We arrive back at the lookout to find Vegeta and Trunks exiting the time chamber, as they head off to fight Cell. Now it's time to see who goes in next. On my last video, the majority of you voted that they wanted to see Broly go in the time chamber with Goku, his teacher, so the next two people to go in the time chamber are, naturally, Goku and Broly. This time is also spent training their current power, with Goku trying to teach Broly Super Saiyan as well. Even if Broly goes berserk, it's worth a shot, because there's no Dragon Balls, no second chances, so they need all the power they can get. Gohan is also in a pretty bad mood right now, obviously. First, he loses Piccolo. Now he feels kinda neglected by both his father and his new friend Broly, by the fact that Goku decided to go in the time chamber first with Broly instead of him. Remember, Gohan is only a kid still, and he's gonna act that way. Of course he'd get jealous from this. It makes him feel like he's too weak, and like he won't help at all with defeating Cell, even though he's a Super Saiyan now. This is where we see a change in Gohan's character for this arc. He begins to get more of a motivation to fight because of a combination of him wanting to prove himself, and for him wanting to prevent the loss of any more friends in the future. The encounter with Cell and Vegeta goes pretty normally. Cell searches for 18, he fights Vegeta and Trunks, and Krillin destroys the remote to kill 18. Cell absorbs 18, and we now have perfect Cell, just like normal. Gohan senses this power from the lookout and feels even more of a desire to become stronger now, seeing that Cell just became massively stronger. Cell killed Piccolo, and Gohan wants to be the one to end him. For Paragus, it's kind of the opposite. Paragus is beginning to feel left behind. He was weaker than everyone else already, but now he's really behind everyone. He feels useless. All of his training feels like it goes for nothing, when everyone else is now exponentially stronger than him. We'll see this come into play as well. Of course, with Cell becoming perfect, the events away from the lookout still go pretty much the same as normal, with Cell proposing the idea of the Cell Games so everyone can get stronger so he can truly test his perfection. Android 16 is also taken to Capsule Corp to be fixed and reprogrammed like normal. The Cell Games are announced, and a day passes as Goku and Broly exit the time chamber. Goku is able to teach Broly Super Saiyan, although Broly is in a very volatile state while in the form. He can control it partially, but not well, and is very prone to outbursts that make him berserk. But he's still able to somewhat transform on command, and for the days coming up to the Cell Games, this training also means Goku never actually achieved Super Saiyan Grade 4 in the time chamber. Well, he didn't master it. He knows it exists, but since it was so difficult teaching Broly about Super Saiyan, Goku only had time to teach himself Grade 3, and rather than having full access to the perfected Super Saiyan form, Super Saiyan Grade 4, at best, he's just aware that it exists. After this, it's Gohan's turn to go in with Goku. In the time chamber, they both have a head start as opposed to normal. Goku already knows Super Saiyan Grade 3, and Gohan has Grade 1, but Goku knows he can go beyond Grade 3, and that is his new goal. Him and Gohan are easily able to reach Super Saiyan Grade 4, the mastered form, in less time because they also have a head start. Despite Goku being ahead, Gohan is still able to quickly catch up due to him already being a Super Saiyan and having the motivation to train. Knowing that Broly and Gohan are both more powerful now, Goku is feeling really confident about fighting Cell. And to avoid any further berserker moments, Goku also trains Gohan to fully master his wrathful form that we saw in the last part. With this training, Gohan can now easily use this form as if it were just his base form, kinda like Broly does. But for now, Gohan trains his Super Saiyan forms instead because during the extra time they have in the time chamber, it's better to train this because they're more powerful. But during this time, Goku discovers something. They're both getting stronger in this perfected Super Saiyan form, but one day, Gohan and Goku are training, and Gohan ends up powering up farther than Goku's ever witnessed before. His hair spikes up even further and electricity appears around him before he drops out of the form. This, of course, is Super Saiyan 2. Goku and Gohan continue to train to pursue this form and end up leaving the time chamber soon after. Goku himself wasn't able to access Super Saiyan 2, but given their head start and Gohan's motivation to train, Gohan is actually able to kinda use it now off the bat, but he does require some effort to actually turn into it, and he can't completely do it at will. At best, he just knows of its existence, and he has a little bit of experience with it. And of course, as we know, people can only enter the time chamber twice in their lives before Dende fixed it. And of course, this would mean Goku couldn't go back in with Gohan, because he already went in once during Dragon Ball. But the way I'm gonna get around this is kinda stupid, but we're gonna say that since Goku was only in there for 1 month in the original Dragon Ball, we're just gonna say he can only go in 11 months this time, and it adds up to 2 years, and that counts as him going in twice in his lifetime. Kind of a cop-out, but it's a good way to help this story continue the way it is. And they got a head start on their training anyway, so leaving a month early doesn't really matter too much to them. Vegeta and Trunks are about to head into the time chamber, but Paragus perks up and asks if he can join them. The three of them can go in at once, but it just means that there's going to be less of a food supply, because there's only enough food to supply two people for a year. Obviously, Vegeta isn't too enthusiastic about this since Paragus is pretty weak, but this could be interesting for him to train Paragus and have another strong Saiyan on their side. This means, since there's less food, they go in for less amount of time, but since Paragus is there, it's a third person, so the training gets more effective between the three of them. Time passes and the day has finally come. The Cell Games begin. Everyone, including a newly empowered Paragus and Vegeta, head to the site of the Cell Games, with some new tricks.
You two aren't the only ones who have mastered Super Saiyan, Kakarot.
Vegeta powers up to Super Saiyan Grade 4, just like Goku, having mastered it in the time chamber.
Both him and Trunks now have access to the mastered Super Saiyan form.
Our training has been pretty fruitful. Go and show the rest what you've learned, Paragus.
Paragus, in response, begins to power up. the weakest of the Saiyans, ends up surprising everyone now. For the first time, Paragus is a Super Saiyan as well. Vegeta didn't want to have a weak training partner, so he was able to whip Paragus into shape and get him to become a Super Saiyan, mainly so Vegeta could train more effectively. Given his feelings about being inadequate and his doubt in himself, Paragus was able to channel these emotions during this time, alongside the rigorous training, and allowed him to finally transform. He no longer has any need for his Grade 8 form. The only thing is, he's just a Super Saiyan Grade 1, so it's not very efficient for him to use, but it's better than nothing. Now there are 6 Super Saiyans, with the humans and Android 16 there as well. Oh yeah, and Mr. Satan. Here's a list of all of their powers in order, with their best transformations beside them. Even with Broly and Gohan's immense power, remember, Broly is prone to going berserk as a Super Saiyan still, and Gohan requires some effort to go Super Saiyan 2 at this point. The only real difference is that he has experience and knows it exists. With all this firepower, the Z Fighters are confident in their fight with Cell. First we have Cell vs. Goku, which goes pretty normally. However, there's no instant transmission Kamehameha, for obvious reasons. The fight isn't really going anywhere, so Goku ends it and just lets someone else have a turn to go, and he turns to Broly. He knows Cell's strong, but Goku wants Broly to end this since Goku wants to get everything back to normal ASAP. No Senzu Bean this time. Goku has no sympathy for Cell because he killed Piccolo and nearly killed Tien. Broly begins to fight in his wrathful form, and is doing pretty well. He's in his wrathful form because he's afraid that if he goes Super Saiyan, he'll just go berserk and end up causing more damage than good. The few times he's ever gone Super Saiyan, he lost control, and he's barely ever come close to controlling it without exhausting himself. Cell keeps pushing him to power up more and more, and during the fight, he ends up stabbing Broly with his tail and draining some of his power. And as we know with Broly, a fraction of his power equates to a lot more power than if it were anyone else. Cell gets a huge power up, and Broly realizes if he wants to end this, he has one choice. He's backed into a corner, and he finally powers up into his Super Saiyan. Shockwaves cause the entire area to tremble. The light from the transformation dissipates, revealing Broly with golden hair and yellow eyes like in his wrathful form. Surprising for Broly, he's not berserk. He's elated by this, and he's confident now. He smirks as he rushes towards the empowered Cell with tremendous speed. With quick punches and kicks, Broly overwhelms Cell and finishes him off with a blast from his mouth that seemingly vaporizes the android. With his confidence, Broly doesn't even use all of his power in the blast because the gap between Cell and him is so large. The dust settles and Cell is gone. Is it over? Everyone is glad to have defeated Cell, and pretty easily. Broly powers down, a little tired from controlling the form, but he has a newfound confidence. He no longer has a fear of turning Super Saiyan or going berserk, and he's happy that he was easily able to defeat Cell. Or so they think. Broly made one mistake with the way he finished off Cell. Like I said, he didn't use all of his power, and thought what he used was enough, and now he dropped his guard. In the distance, a shockwave and smoke and electricity appears. A large red beam pierces through the smoke. The beam strikes the distracted Broly right in his chest, directly on his scar. This not only pierces through Broly completely, but reopens the scar. If the wound from the beam didn't do the job, the blood loss will. Broly falls to the ground, motionless.
It seems you forgot I could regenerate.
The smoke clears, a newly empowered Cell standing there. Since Broly didn't use all of his power, Cell's core remained intact, and he came back more powerful than ever in his super perfect form. Catching Broly off guard allowed Cell to kill the Saiyan, much to everyone's surprise.
You bastard!
Paragus immediately powers up to his Super Saiyan and rushes towards Cell in a blind rage, only to be easily knocked into the ground unconscious with one hit from Cell. Goku begins to power up out of anger, but stops when he feels another energy rising. Gohan. First Piccolo, then Broly. Gohan mutters to himself, tears streaming down his face. His eyes turn blank and he lets out a loud scream of rage, with an explosion of power flowing through the area. Gohan is once again a Super Saiyan 2, but not like normal. Gohan's hair is even more defined, and his aura has a blue tint to it. Gohan has tapped into his rage and is in a new form, Super Saiyan Rage. Similar to what Trunks did in Dragon Ball Super using his rage and the power of Super Saiyan 2 to transform, Gohan has done the same. There's no real info on how this form is obtained other than intense rage, and it's pretty similar to what Vegeta did against Beerus, but apparently it's its own thing. It's kinda ambiguous, but this transformation still kinda fits with the context of the situation, and I think it's nice to include here. The combination of Gohan's intense anger in the past, his massive potential, and the power of Super Saiyan 2 work together to create this mutated power. With all of his power, Gohan rushes to Cell
and lands a kick so hard that it takes Cell's arm off when he tries to block it casually. Cell is both surprised and furious. He regenerates the arm, but Gohan delivers a punch in the gut with such force that it temporarily paralyzes Cell by knocking the wind out of him, with Gohan following up with a flurry of punches that causes Cell to break into pieces. He regenerates again from this, losing more ki each time he regenerates. He considers blowing himself up, but with the overwhelming power and speed of Gohan's new form, he doesn't even have time to utilize an opening to do so. He grabs Cell by his legs and spins him around so fast that Cell becomes a blur. He flings the nearly unconscious Cell into the air. "This is for Piccolo, Broly, and everyone you've killed!" Gohan unleashes a Kamehameha larger than anyone's ever seen, even bigger than the Solar or Father-Son Kamehameha in the original battle of Gohan vs. Cell. It flies far off into space and is hundreds, no, thousands of feet in diameter as it expands further out. The power is felt across the reaches of the galaxy by King Kai, his peers, and even the Namekians. Cell stands no chance. Within an instant, he's completely disintegrated and won't regenerate this time. Panting, Gohan powers down and descends to the ground, but not completely out of energy. The rage transformation is very draining to maintain after all. He lost two of his friends, but he won. He achieves his goal of avenging his friend Piccolo, and now Broly. The mood is bittersweet. While the present fighters are still shocked, even a little scared at the power of Gohan that he just showed, they're still proud, and they celebrate the defeat of Cell, with Paragus staying behind for a bit, after being healed with the Senzu. Not even his new Super Saiyan form was enough to defeat Cell, and Broly still ended up dying. If anything, he feels like he got in the way. While Vegeta doesn't vow to stop fighting in this timeline, Paragus does instead. He snaps back to reality and flies off with the others. Now the objective is to revive Piccolo, Broly, and everyone killed by Cell. But there's no Dragon Balls. Even before Piccolo died, the Dragon Balls were gone, so Earth needs a new guardian. Goku has no instant transmission, and he can't get to Namek now, but King Kai gets an idea. King Kai, even the Namekians too, they felt the power of what happened, and they know the Earth is in peril. He contacts the Namekians and tells them what just happened, and how one of their own is dead. The Namekians realize their friend from Earth are in trouble, and they want to help. Everyone on Earth feels a sudden surge of power from two sources. Gohan instantly recognizes what's happening and smiles. He senses both Broly and Piccolo are alive again. Broly's body was brought to the lookout before, and he comes to life first. He comes from around the corner to greet Paragus, Goku, and Gohan again. Piccolo, having been buried where he died, flies up to the lookout soon after with a smirk on his face. But there's a third wish, and knowing that the Earth still needs a guardian, Dende volunteers to do so, and a wish is made to teleport him to Earth. And thus, we have a happy conclusion of this arc. Piccolo and Broly are alive, Dende's the new guardian, and he makes a new set of Dragon Balls that are used to make two wishes, bring everyone back to life, and then Krillin butts in and makes a wish for the androids to have their bombs removed, now that they're alive again. And we all know why he did that. The conclusion to this arc is where we'll end this part for now. This part was pretty fun to make, and I was able to take some liberties, but still keep it somewhat realistic. What did you think about this part? What would you like to see in the Buu Saga next time? Let me know in the comments below, and remember to like the video and subscribe, and hit the bell icon to be notified of any future videos if you like this one, so you can be notified of any continuations of this What If or any new videos. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you all next time.